Mm-hmm. That was fun. Yeah. You've done this before.
Yeah, I went to his place and there's like, it's like the longest interview ever done. It's like all uncut. We talked for like an hour.
Oh, you were?
For this?
Not interested in running up.
Where did this start for you, Dustin?
The genesis was my first job out of college, which was it was working at a place very similar to the one that's portrayed in the movie, and it was a very momentous portion of my life that I learned the most about myself, and it was that experience just stuck with me until I finally had enough distance from it to organize it and put it into a screenplay format. And then that was the short film, Short Term 12, and then it later turned into the feature.
So you just kind of had to tell the story? Was that the compulsion, or was it being a filmmaker and you had this great story?
Well, it was also being in film school and I had an assignment, so I had to do a thesis project. And I had these journal entries from that section of my life that were all incredibly emotional to me still. And so this was, initially it was just a way to kind of organize those thoughts and put them into a story.
And did you get this kind of feedback you've been getting for the last couple years from the beginning, or did people have a sense that there was something special and interesting going on, or just?
You know, I just went and made it with friends, and we weren't expecting anything to turn of it. But with the short, it premiered at Sundance and then won the jury prize there, and the response to it on the festival circuit was actually much better than I expected, because I thought it was a tiny story that not many people would relate to, but that was my first clue that a lot of these emotions and scenarios were very universal, and which became kind of the inspiration for taking it into a feature.
Did you get an A, at least?
I'm not sure if it... I don't know what I got.
That is very interesting, because I remember the brief period of time that I tried to go to film school, and I had to write a paper on the color and composition for a film.
Uh-huh.
And did I tell you this?
I don't know.
Oh.
I'm not sure yet.
Well, I was very excited because I thought, oh, I'm going to go to school, I'm going to go to film school. And so I decided, at first I was annoyed by the assignment because I thought, well, I don't really know, it's just my perspective on the color and composition. I don't know the DP of anything, you know, I don't know the color corrector. So I wrote this paper on the hours, because that would be quite interesting to talk about the three different periods of time and what to talk about. And the paper came back, the teacher was like, oh, it's sitting, and the teacher was very uninspired. And the papers were on the table. And I went, and my paper got a D, and it was in between two other papers, and one was on A Walk to Remember, and one was on Resident Evil Extinction, and those got A's. And I still have that paper, because I was so angry about it, and I never went back. I'm a very good sport.
Resident Evil Extinction.
Is that the fourth one or the third one?
Oh, I don't know.
You're no Paul W.S. Anderson, sir. Somebody knows him well.
He does some great things with color composition.
Mm-hmm.
Particularly in Event Horizon. You ever see that movie?
Mm-mm.
It's a horror movie in space.
Mm.
That he did. Before.
Sounds great.
It's pretty good.
It sounds like my worst nightmare. Space is the scariest thing to me.
Mm-hmm.
What's your earliest memory of ice cream?
The mint chocolate chip ice cream. Oh no, I know what it is. Those Ninja Turtle
Pops?
Popsicle things that you get from the ice cream man that I wanted so bad every time and then never liked it. I never thought it tasted good. I just wanted it because it looked like the Ninja Turtle. I didn't like bubble gum, and that was what the eyes were made out of. But I just, and it was this constant thing of like the ice cream man would come, you know, just, ice cream man, and mom would be like, you don't even want it. Like you don't even like it. I would kind of cry because I really wanted that Michelangelo and didn't even really like it.
I remember getting like a cup of chocolate, like Breyers ice cream, and sitting on the steps in my house and eating it. And my dad called me John Boy growing up, like the Waltons. And he walked by and he said, John Boy, you look like you're in heaven.
Oh, that's so cute.
I was just like,
that is so cute.
Having this chocolate ice cream and like on cloud nine.
That sounds like, and I was like, an old-timey
what's
movie.
I think I'm there.
I can't wait to go to heaven. There must be ice cream there.
What is heaven, Dad? I think this is it.
We didn't have ice cream trucks on Maui, but we did have our version. Did you have this Goody Goody when we were there? Did I take you there?
I don't think I had Goody
Goody. Goody Goody. G-U-R-I, G-U-R-I. It's like Maui's version of ice cream. And you actually eat it with this same wooden spoon out of a little cup. And it's made out of, I think it's made out of some kind of soybean or something, but that's, and there's only two flavors, strawberry and pineapple. If anyone ever goes to Maui, go to the Maui Mall.
That's not enough option.
Go to Goody Goody.
I want vanilla.
And get the ice cream. When we were young, you would get it with beans. It'd be ice cream and beans.
Oh, yeah, like the paste or stuff?
Azuki beans, yeah.
Yeah, those are good.
Kind of sweet.
Yeah.
In Delaware, where I grew up, you would get an Italian ice, like a little thing, like Italian ice, where it's like a shaved ice. But in the Delaware, Pennsylvania area, it's called water ice.
Oh, yeah, water ice.
Yeah, water ice.
Yeah, water ice.
And especially with the accent, which is, like, kind
of
weird.
But isn't there marshmallow on top of it? I thought sometimes they put marshmallow fluff on top of it.
I never had that. I only had just, like, the lemon or the cherry one. But water ice, what an interesting thing.
The in Maui, the Hawaii shave ice, which I don't know why they don't call it shaved. Hawaii shave ice.
We like to abbreviate.
Oh, it's so everything. Good. It was the best thing.
The water ice is a weird
name. There's a truck here.
Here? Yeah. At this hotel?
No, that drives around L.A.
Oh, I thought truck. I was like...
But to call something water ice, it's like...
What does that mean?
They're the same... It's the same, two
tomato
the same
ketchup.
Things. It's like tomato ketchup.
Yeah.
Wood ash.
Water ice steam.
Water vapor.
So was there ice cream on the set when people were really good?
There was an ice cream truck.
No, we did have an ice cream truck. Way to transition.
Just like an organic gourmet ice cream sandwich truck came by one day.
It was so exciting. The last day that the kids were there.
The kids were going crazy. And we were going, the adults were also going crazy.
It was a surprise. The producer surprised us. We had been working. And then they came in and they're like, there's an ice cream truck outside. I think I ran faster out that door than
she was knocking kids over.
Get out of my way.
That's how you got the shots of you running across the lawn.
Yeah.
Yeah. That, they just they parked it.
I was
they had to CGI the ice cream truck out. Because that's what she was running for.
I was so happy.
So, how did you gather your core acting talent here? What was that process?
Brie came first. And John came second, and then everybody else came afterwards. There was both Bree and John. We when we were looking for people, it was just by looking at their reels, they just felt initially got me very excited to meet them and talk to them about the role. And then they both responded to the script, and I Skyped with Bree, and just during that one Skype conversation, I was really, I mean, I. By the end of the conversation, I couldn't see anyone else playing it, so, and thank goodness she wanted to do it. And then same happened with John. A lot of what sold me on John was his beard that he had grown at that time. He actually looked, as soon as he popped up, I was like, that is exactly how I pictured Mason looking. And so, and then talking to him for 20 seconds, it was just, it was kind of a very exciting conversation for me.
And what sold you guys and her director? Same conversations, I guess?
The script was incredible. It was probably the best screenplay that I've ever read as an actor. And
Don't tell Aaron.
And, well, I've never read one of his screenplays, only his teleplays. TV film, different mediums, you see.
Well, that was good.
That was good.
But, yeah, it was incredible the way that it evoked emotion so effortlessly without being manipulative or sentimental was a balance that I don't think I'd ever seen struck on paper like that before. And to get so choked up reading a screenplay, something that doesn't happen very often. And so that initially floored me. And then I watched the short film that it's based on and what that accomplished in the tiny amount of time that it did, 8 or 10 minutes or so.
22 minutes.
Is it 22 minutes, however it long
like
it was. I turned it off after 8 or 10 minutes. Is it that long? I thought it was so much shorter.
22 minutes.
22 minutes. what it did in 22 minutes felt like 8 or 10 because it moved so fast. Because I was fast forwarding.
Where's my part?
Wait, I'm not in this? But the lead guy's a girl in the... What? No, that was so impressive to me. And then the kicker was Skyping with Destin and then talking to him just for a short amount of time. That was all I needed to feel like I had total faith and trust in him.
And Bree feels the same way.
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. It feels...
What did that? Can you translate that at all?
You didn't understand what I meant when I went...
You put subtitles on under that.
Man, Destin's pretty cool.
Bree watched the short and was like, what the short does in 4 minutes. Wow.
I just felt underqualified to do it, so I was less concerned about him and more concerned about myself. The script was so great, I didn't question his ability. I just thought, if he doesn't hire me, he might be smart. He might be smarter than me. I don't know. I knew that I could do it, but I'd never done something like it before to say, I can guarantee you that I can do this. And we're also talking about something that is in a lot of ways like an intangible thing to talk about. You can't, and we've watched, they're cutting together this like behind the scenes things from filming, and it's really funny watching this video of the two of us trying to talk about what's going on with Grace, and it's kind of impossible to. It's just a mutual understanding.
Would you want somebody, Destin, who knew that they could do it?
No.
I mean, isn't that kind of a...
Because I didn't know that I could do it. I mean, I think it's really fun going into a project with where everybody is doing something that they haven't really done before. That's the way I love working with people who are all coming to a story and coming to it with humility. I mean, I think it's with the confidence that we're going to do it together, but also without any bit of ego attached to it. And I didn't sense that in these guys, and I think that was a huge it was a huge contribution to what we were trying to achieve on set, which was an environment that is really conducive to great creativity, which is just a fun environment and one that doesn't have ego attached to it. And it really, we were trying to, as best we could, create a family that lasted the 20 days that we were shooting. And
then, thank God, never saw each other again.
Yeah.
So we just get through
that. Yeah. Until now.
It's like, we just have to be a family for 20 days.
Just keep it together for the vacation. I hope we can just keep it together for Christmas, and then we could all go home.
So is it different? Would you go into this thinking of it as anything different than you had done in terms of doing the short? I mean, obviously, it's a slightly bigger crew and things like that, but...
Yeah.
Was it daunting as a change, or was it really just an extension of the experience you already had?
I was scared out of my mind going into this project. I was
funny because I thought, what a clear person. And meanwhile, he's like, his hands are peeling. I was like, God, what a leader.
I was like, man, he is unfathomable.
Yeah, I just thought, what patience. He's so calm and so knows exactly what he wants to do, and inside he's like just shitting himself.
Yeah, inside I'm like giving myself pep talks nonstop. Like, it's all gonna be fine. We got it all under control. But my hands do tell everything. I peeled like the entire first layer of skin peeled off my hands. And then I started freaking out about that and looked it up online and found out that it's connected to stress, and then I was like, maybe I am stressed out. And then that kind of got in my head, but it most of my stress was stemming from building this team, and when there were holes and like I didn't know who was going to play a certain role, that's where the stress came from, because that part of it feels so impossible to me. How do you find a human out there who is going to be able to be the perfect person for a role? Thank goodness that I couldn't be happier with everyone that we found. And once we had everyone together, like as soon as we started day one, it was so fun. I didn't from that point on, I wasn't scared at all. Like, once we started rolling and once I started seeing things fit together, it just felt really great.
Were you guys scared at all, or do you, once you're in the soup, you just swim in a splash can?
It was a combination, I think. Mm-hmm. I had a lot of anticipation starting, and it's just the first day and the first couple of days are so strange because you're trying to piece together with very little to draw from, and then it gets easier as the days go on. And then I felt good for a little bit, and then I remember hitting exactly the 10-day mark, and I didn't even realize that it was exactly 10 days, but I had hit the middle point, I guess, in my thought process. And I remember just going home and having a total meltdown because I thought, I can't change anything, you know? Like, I've really screwed this up, and now what if I want to do this totally different, and I can't do it different now, and I've, like, you know, and then the other side of my brain's like, Brie, you made this bed, and you've got to sleep with it. The other side of my brain's like, you'll be fine, like, it's fine, everyone, you know, it's fine, just eat an ice cream. And I was like, no, you can't, like, and so I felt very conflicted and confused because you're at this weird point where you're like, you know, there's no, the first couple of days you have a little bit of room to kind of like pad yourself, and you think, well, you know, I've got these other scenes that I can do to make up for the fact that I really am sucky in these ones, and you think, oh, it'll all kind of even out at the end, and then once it gets closer to the end and there's less to deal with, you're like, and then when it's really done, I usually have a couple of days of feeling like I need to like go for a couple of jogs a day, because you just have this feeling of like, it's done, you know, there's nothing. I can't go back and change anything. I can't call Destiny and be like, hey, actually, can we get the crew back together? I just realized something. It's just done. And you start realizing how bizarre the whole process is, how strange it is that we restrain ourselves to these things. You know, Destin wrote this thing a couple years ago, and then on this day at this time at this point in my life and with these thoughts and this past experience and these things that I hope for, it creates this thing that we all agree on.
So was Brie ever sucky? Was there a bad,
yeah,
I mean, was there in the
course.
First couple of days, did you feel you needed to mold her, or was she already kind of where you wanted her to be?
Brie is awesome.
Well, you knew that.
John is awesome. Everyone's great.
But I mean, have you done your work by casting her?
I think that, oh yeah. I mean, I think there's definitely, we all had to learn how to work together. I think there's a very natural learning curve that all of us were learning how to communicate, how to get to that place where we all felt comfortable and able to just fail and not think that someone's going to bite our heads off, you know? And I think once we all knew that that wasn't going to happen, that it just became very fun and creative set to be a part of. It was very fulfilling.
Were you wrecked with anxiety, John? Or
I'm scared on a daily basis. I live in fear.
Staring off into the distance.
There's a guy outside the window. He's like, look at him.
No, he's just cutting the grass.
He's got his one hand on his dagger in his back pocket.
Brandon Peters have been stalking you.
Totally.
She's not.
No, I hate to disappoint people. I'm always scared that I will. With a script so good, and then meeting someone so special who had written and was going to, you know, be at the helm the whole time, there's definitely anxiety for me that I'm going to let people down, that I'm not going to live up to it, that I'm not going to be good enough. And then by the same token, that fear that it's not going to be good enough for my standards, because, you know, I hold myself to a probably unrealistically high standard sometimes. But that washed away pretty quick. After a couple days of on set, just getting used to the environment and, like Destin said, the learning curve of working with each other. Once that started happening, once we all started bonding, it so quickly felt like everybody was just understanding each other and kind of, you know, operating the same manual. And
she just
kind of
let
page.
Destin be your North Star at that point?
Yeah, definitely. I think you have to.
Whereas on like series television, I think it's probably harder because your directors are changing every week.
Yeah, the directors change all the time. And they don't even really, they're not really in control. You know, they're there, but for the grace of, you know, HBO and our producers and Aaron Sorkin and stuff. So it's a very, very different environment. And it lasts for 6 months. What if we shot this for 6 months?
I would have been happy.
It would have been great. Mm-hmm. Probably one of the best.
Wasn't there a rumor?
But only if you directed it. I wouldn't want a new director to come in every week and or every 10 days and be like. Because I remember that from United States of Terra. It was a very shocking thing. Because I'd gone through, I tested, and then I didn't get it, and then they shot the pilot, and then I came back, went through the testing process again, all with the same director, mm-hmm. who was very, I was very close with. And he really fought for me to get the job twice. And then he did the first four episodes, I think, of the first season. And then I will never forget the moment when they switched directors, and it was like we were in the middle of the day, and we were done with one, and then the new guy came in, like, okay, here's this new guy. And the new guy came in, and he had, like, an accent. He was, like, British, and came in, and he was like, okay, so Brie, you're going to be over here. And he started telling me what I was going to do, and I instantly just had this feeling of, like, no, you know, I don't know. I'm just dropping my dad. It's a strange feeling. It's like a whole new level of learning, of trusting yourself in the character. And I remember calling that director that I had worked with before, and I said, well, these directors are asking me to do things that I don't think are right. And he said, well, you have to fight for her. And that changed so many things for me, because I realized that there is such an importance, and we owe something to these characters that we play to do right by them.
I was at the Academy for a screening the other night, and Thomas Carter was there, who did, like, every major hour-long pilot for, like, 5 years. He was, like, the guy who did Miami Vice, the first Miami Vice episode, not Michael Mann. But, you know, the vision of the show was Michael Mann's, but it's like he kind of set the look of each of these shows that were hits over and over, and then he left. He only did one episode of any show. And it was such a strange...
And he made the most money.
He made an enormous amount of money, because he was, like, gold. It was like Jim Burrows in a comedy. You want, you know, like, of course he goes and stays with the show usually, but... They're like guys who just kind of like do their little magic act, and then on television they get to disappear.
Come in and set it up. And then.
Yeah. So was there a time during this 20 days where you knew everything was going well and you were in the groove?
Yeah. There's never a time, at least in anything that I've done, where I'm thinking, oh, this is going to be a successful movie. But there is a time where you forget about all the stressful parts of making a movie, because the relationships have become so real and strong that it really feels like a team. It feels like if we go down, we're all going down together, and it's still going to be all right. Like, it's not just all the pressure is on one person, you know. And I think that a lot of the turning point for me is when people start feeling comfortable enough to laugh and start, you know, joking around with each other, which happened pretty quickly. So,
do you have enough footage for Short Term 13 and 14? Or it seems like a film that looked like it had a lot of extra stuff.
I think we're gonna have probably. I was actually just looking at the deleted scenes just the other day, and it was. We're going to have some really great deleted scenes when we release.
I just got them sent to me.
Did you see them?
I haven't watched them yet.
Oh, they're like, they're in my email. They're really good.
I started watching the long dance take, and I got too embarrassed, and I turned it off.
Really?
Yeah. It's like that one where I'm dancing by myself for like 5 minutes.
So good.
But I was like, nope. Oh, God, it won't stop. Stop it.
You'll never stop. We should turn that into a Vine video. Just a loop.
A loop of my weird dance moves.
I think it's 5 minutes straight of just dancing.
It's pretty cool, though. Because we did do a lot of dancing that night.
Yeah.
He'll play it for you on your 50th birthday.
Yeah, but maybe I'll be brave enough to take a look at it.
So was it hard to cut? I mean, did you have stuff that you really wanted to squeeze in, or that you just had to decide to let go when you got in the post? Or
yeah, there was a lot of things that I wanted to, that the director part of me wanted to keep in, but the editor and alongside Nat, like, you know, once we got into that room, I clung to certain things, but... And, you know, I also know how important editing is. I've edited most of the things in the past. And so at some point, we just had to let things go. And the best scene that I've ever been a part of is not in the movie, because it just didn't fit. But it'll be on the deleted scenes. I just watched it, and it's just as good as
it is.
It is so good.
I have not seen since it happened. But
it's a dance scene involving.
I think it's the best thing that I've ever done.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it's so.
It's the
good.
Weirdest thing I've ever done.
It's very weird and very good.
We'll leave it at that. It's not in the movie, but.
No, I shouldn't have detracted by making a joke, because it is a really incredible scene. I haven't seen it, but I read it. Yeah. And I was like, well, I know that it's going
to
be amazing.
Well, you'll get to see it.
Can't wait.
Yeah, it's really good.
And now that you're pushing it out for the third or fourth time, it must feel like, since January, does it feel like is it a surprise every time you get to the next stage of letting this thing go? And will it feel, do you think, when you finally release it,
that so you're like, this kind is still of going?
Done? Or does it just keep on going forever? Is the DVDs next?
Yeah. Oh, my gosh.
I haven't gotten tired of these guys yet, so I'm having a good time. Anytime we get to another stage, we get to hang out more, so it's fun.
We get ice cream.
Yeah, we get to eat ice cream.
Good coffee. Consistently good coffee. Yeah.
Was South by a surprise for you? Or did you, were you expecting the rousing ovation?
I wasn't expecting to even get into South by, so yeah, everything about it was a surprise. It was wonderful. It was an incredible experience on every level. Watching the other films, getting to know the other filmmakers, and then just the feeling of family amongst both the viewers and the staff members of South by Southwest was just a really all around healthy, wonderful way to premiere a movie.
Mm. And in a film like this, where the story's so personal, is that another layer of that experience? Obviously it's nice to have people love your film and be happy and go, it's great, but does it connect with you in that personal way still when an audience kind of gets you?
Yeah, that was one. I had this experience sitting in the back of one of our screenings at South by Southwest when we first played in that big theater. Mm-hmm. And I was sitting in the back and nobody knew that I was there. And as I was feeling people react to different things, there's certain moments in the movie where there's always a reaction, but in that screening, there are certain things that are just small little things, like when Grace tells Mason that she's, should I give up? Anyway, there's a moment where Mason like discovers something about Grace and he thinks it's a joke, and he has this big smile, and then his smile just slowly creeps into this like shock. And the first time I saw it, I lost my poop. I was just.
You can say shit. Okay.
Because you thought it was funny.
I would thought it was so funny, and that was in that screening. That was the first time that. It was like so much laughter in that moment.
Awesome.
And I, it's just a simple thing, but I felt so moved and connected to everybody there. Because that little moment, it's not a joke. It's not something that's like, it made me feel like I'm very similar to so many people in this room. It's what it felt like, and as that whole throughout that whole screening, the same thing happened with moments where everyone was quiet and they felt touched by certain things. I felt very connected to all the humans in that room. It was nice.
So your next film will be Taylor Lautner and a lot of running and shooting. Mm-hmm. And
that's what I'm hoping. Mm-hmm.
Are you ambitious in that way at all, or do you just want to make another interesting, or are you looking for the right next story that is worth telling?
Yeah, I have no other interest but telling stories that I feel like are worth telling. I have no other interest in that.
So can you imagine ever blowing stuff up as a...
If it's interesting to blow something up, then maybe it would be...
Maybe there's a reason for it.
I mean, I'm not against, there's certain... I love The Matrix, so it's...
Well, The Matrix
stinking.
Is a whole other thing.
Well, get ready for the long coats and the leather outfits.
I am so in. I love The Matrix.
I think you'd make a great action movie.
Because
it would
could.
Be the thinking, feeling man's action movie, which doesn't often get made anymore.
The thinking, feeling man's action movie.
Hey, you could do the next Blade Runner. Yeah, the next Blade Runner would be so good.
Yeah, is it a reboot?
Are you a thinking, feeling man?
Are you doing the Blade Runner?
Harrison Ford as the thinking, feeling man. Damn it, I won't take this anymore. I'm feeling shit, I'm not going to take it.
Get off my therapy couch.
Thinking, feeling man, coming to a theater near you. Directed by Destin
Daniel Cretton.
A Cretton film. I'd see that movie, but I support you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm glad. I'm glad we all know what I'm doing next.
We've got it figured out.
Mm-hmm.